Hello everyone, and welcome to the sixth session of the Genomic Variant Analysis and Clinical Interpretation course. In this session, we will be learning how to annotate variant features using online resources. So I hope by now you're all familiar with the terms such as genetic variants and how they may be inherited or how they may cause a disease. Just a quick brush up of these concepts. Humans accumulate over 100 mutations in their genome every generation. Considering we have a genome that is more than a billion bases long, this number may not seem like much. But as an analogy, let's consider the word cake, a simple and a harmless thing. By changing a single letter, the word cake can transform into Coke. A harmless change, yet the meaning is altered. The word Coke can undergo a series of changes and ultimately get transformed into the word sick, a not so harmless thing anymore, which also forms the basis of genetic disorders that in the wrong place, even a single variant can be fatal. So let us look at an example of such a disorder known as hemophilia B. It is a disease that plagued the royal family of England for generations, because of which it is also known as the royal disease. It is a rare blood condition caused by a deficiency of the clotting factor in blood, which leads to excessive bleeding through wounds and can eventually lead to even death. It is inherited in an X-linked recessive manner, meaning that it will manifest mostly in males if they inherit the diseased copy of the X chromosome. The disease was very prevalent in European royalties, though no one at that time understood the cause or the genetic basis of the disease. The disease spanned several generations in the royal family from 1819 to 1901. Queen Victoria is thought to be a carrier of the disease, which she passed on to her son Leopold, who died due to excessive bleeding after an accident, and also to her daughters Princess Alice and Princess Beatrice, who then passed it on to their children and so on. Most affected male members in this family died due to the disease, and the transmission line is thought to have stopped only when the remaining heirs were killed in the Russian Revolution. Almost a century later, in 2009, when next generation sequencing technologies came up, researchers were able to sequence the genetic material found in decaying bones of the royal family. They discovered a mutation in the F9 gene, or the blood coagulation factor 9 gene, a gene in which defects are known to cause the disease hemophilia B. And this is the mutation they discovered on sequencing. This particular mutation was found in a heterozygous form for the female members that were sequenced, and all affected male members that they sequenced had the variant in a homozygous form, which led the researchers to conclude that this mutation probably caused hemophilia B in the royal family. Thus, the advent of next generation sequencing can help us shift from the classical medicine approach of one size fits all, in which people having the same symptoms will receive the same diagnosis and treatment, which could either have no benefits at all or cause harmful effects. Through a personalized medicine approach, we can sequence and uncover the genetic makeup of a patient and thus help provide the right intervention to the right type of patient. This also helps in clinical genomics, in which if a patient comes with some symptoms or a family history of a genetic disorder, we can sequence his genome to uncover and analyze his variants that can help explain his disease or condition. Variant interpretation involves assigning a clinical phenotype or a clinical significance to variants that have been identified in context of a disease having a suspected underlying genetic cause. This evidence can be many things, including family history, experimentally validating the variant, and so on. Based on the amount of evidence gathered for a variant, its clinical significance can range from benign to pathogenic. Benign being a variant for which there is sufficient evidence to prove that this variant will not cause a disease in a patient, And pathogenic is a variant in which for which there is ample evidence to prove that it can cause a disease in a patient. Sequencing the genome and comparing it with the reference genome helps us uncover all the variants that a particular person may possess. In fact, whole genome sequencing can uncover over 1 million variants in each genome sequence. So how do we even find a variant that can be of clinical interest? Given that we uncover over 1 million variants, finding a mutation that may cause a disease is a task as difficult as finding a needle in a haystack. If we have a patient and a set of symptoms or suspected diseases associated with him, using whole genome sequencing to only uncover variants is not enough. We need to know more details about the variants uncovered, such as what are the variation types, what is the molecular consequence of the variant, which genes do the variants lie in, and other information like the amino acid changes, and whether the variant has already been reported in some previous study. And if yes, what was the clinical significance interpreted for the variant in that study? So how do we find the needle in the haystack? By bringing in a big magnet. Given a patient and a heap of variants found in his genome, we need to assign additional information to these variants, such as the genes in which they lie, which will enable us to pick out a subset of variants that interest us, a step known as variant filtering, and ultimately help assign a clinical significance to these variants. And this crucial step of mapping additional information onto variants is known as variant annotation. For example, if we have a patient showing symptoms of hemophilia B, we don't need to view his whole heap of variants. We can annotate them and let's say look at variants that only lie in the gene F9, a gene that we previously know is known to cause hemophilia B. On closer examination of this gene, we find a single nucleotide variant at this position, which is a C2T change. And on further annotation, we find that it is lying in a coding region and it is a non-synonymous change, causing a mutation proline to leucine at the protein at the amino acid position 414. Searching existing databases for this protein change, we find that this variant has already been reported as pathogenic in a previous patient, which is a high amount of evidence to prioritize this variant as a probably disease-causing variant for our patient also. So let us look at what all information can be annotated against our variants and the databases that can help us do this. Firstly, we need to annotate the gene name or the transcript name in which the variant is found. And we will also need to know the type of variant and the functional or molecular consequence of the variant. Next, we need to know if the variant is already known and recorded in databases like DBSNP, and if its frequency of occurrence is known in different populations. It will also be great to know if the variant has been reported in context of a disease in databases such as ClinVar. And finally, we may need to know what computational prediction tools or methods predict the variant as. So let us look at each of these four databases individually. To know the gene or the transcript name in which the variants lie, we can map the variant against the RefSeq database that you have been made familiar with in the previous sessions. Say if we have a variant in this VCF format, mapping it to the RefSeq database will help uncover the gene name, the transcript details in the form of NMIDs and NCIDs, and the protein change, if any, is associated with the variant. Mapping to RefSeq will also help identify the type of variant based on its position in the genome. And based on this, its position, a variant can be either intergenic or upstream or downstream. It can be a UTR variant lying in the 5' or 3' UTR of the gene. It can be an intronic or a splice site variant. And of course, it can lie in an exon and be an exonic variant. Exonic variants can further be annotated regarding their molecular consequence that they may have on the gene, such as it can be a synonymous variant in which the nucleotide base is changing, but the corresponding amino acid remains the same. It can be a non-synonymous change in which the nucleotide base change leads to a change in the amino acid that is being produced after translation. It can be a frame shift variant, such as an insertion of T at this position before CC, which leads to a disruption of the original nucleotide triplets, and thus the amino acid translation is completely different from the original. It can also be a non-frame shift variant, such as an insertion of TTT at this position, in which the original triplet is not getting affected, but an additional amino acid is getting added into the originally translated chain. And of course, it can be a nonsense or a stop gain variant, in which a stop codon gets created in the sequence, leading to a premature truncation of the amino acid chain. Annotation of known variants, such as those reported in dbSNP, and finding the corresponding RSID associated with the variant can help us cover some additional information that already may be reported in the dbSNP database, such as the publications that cite the variant, the population frequencies that may be there for the variant, and its molecular consequence. For example, the previous variant that I had shown you in the VCF format has a corresponding RSID, which is this. And viewing this RSID on the dbSNP database tells us additional information about the variant, such as the gene in which it lies, that is the F9 gene, the molecular consequence, that it is a missense variant or a non-synonymous variant, and the number of publications that have been associated with this variant, and so on. We can also find the occurrence of a variant in different population genome databases. Sequencing healthy individuals from a population can help uncover common variants in that population and rare variants, and thus frequency of occurrence of these variants in that population or the allele frequency can be recorded in the database at the population or subpopulation level. Now, how does this help? In case we are looking at a variant for a rare disorder or a rare disease, we now know since the disease is rare, it should not be present in healthy individuals at all. Or if it is present, or if the variant is present in these databases, the frequency of occurrence or the allele frequency should be very low. Otherwise, it would not be a rare disease at all. Several such databases exist, such as those that use whole genome data, such as 1000 Genomes project that you have heard about before in the previous sessions, and the NOMAD database, which was similarly created using whole genome sequencing data of more than 1000 individuals. Such databases can also be at the whole exome level, such as ASP6500. Next, we need to annotate and check if the variant is already reported in context of a disease in databases such as ClinVar. ClinVar will not only provide the disease name for the variant, it will also provide the interpretation or the clinical significance that has been reported regarding the variant, and the supporting information that has been provided by the submitter regarding the evidence that led them to interpret the variant as pathogenic. Apart from ClinVar, there are other such phenotype or disease association databases that you may want to annotate your variants against, such as variants found in genome-wide association studies, like that are cataloged in the GWAS catalog, or mutations reported in context of human cancer that are stored in the COSMIC database. And finally, we have computational scores and predictions. These computational prediction scores and tools help gather more evidence about the pathogenicity of a variant by predicting the functional impact or the level of effect that the amino acid change will have on protein function and assigning an appropriate score based on that level. Based on the score assigned by a particular tool, the corresponding prediction will range from pathogenic to benign. And based on the tool used, there might be different terminologies associated with the terms pathogenic and benign, such as deleterious or damaging, both denoted as D, possibly damaging, which is denoted as P, tolerated, which is denoted as T, and of course benign, denoted as B. All such computational prediction tools typically define a range of scores that are assigned by them, a cutoff value for the score, and the corresponding prediction based on the cutoff value. For example, SIFT is one such computational tool for which the score ranges from 0 to 1. A score of 0 meaning deleterious and 1 meaning tolerated. The cutoff defined by SIFT is 0.05. And any score between the value of 0 to 0.05 is predicted to be as deleterious, and anything beyond that is predicted to be tolerated. Similarly, Polyfin is another such tool for which the score also ranges from 0 to 1, but in the case of Polyfin, 0 means benign and 1 means damaging or D. There are two cutoffs that are defined by Polyfin, that is 0.453 and 0.9. A score between 0.9 to 1 is predicted as damaging. A score of 0.453 to 0.9 is predicted as possibly damaging or P, and anything below that is predicted to be benign. Apart from these annotations, we can annotate other features onto our variants, such as protein domains. If mutations lie in an important protein domain, normal protein function may be affected. And sequence conservation, in which we check if mutations lie at a position that is conserved or that is the same throughout species, implying that any change at this position may affect normal gene function. Now we know that given a list of variants, variant annotation will bring us closer to assigning a clinical significance to the variants. And to help us perform this tedious task of variant annotation, many tools have been made available by different labs and institutes, such as Variant Effect Predictor by Ensemble. Variant Effect Predictor is a tool that can be accessed through a web browser also. Alternatively, there are other tools such as ANOVAR that you can download and run on your own systems also. Before moving on to explore and use these tools further, let us first see what are the input file formats that may be used to input our variants into these tools. First is the VCF file that you have learned about in previous sessions. As a quick revision, VCF or variant call format is a text file that has tab-separated columns, and the file contains a list of variants. The initial lines of the VCF file that begin with a double hash character have information regarding the different columns in the VCF file. The main section consists of 8 mandatory columns that include chromosome, position, reference, and alternate base information, and additional columns may be there. In case we have variants that we have curated from literature, we can create a VCF file out of those variants by filling in the 8 mandatory fields or columns separated by tabs. The only thing that we need to know for this is the chromosome number, the position, the reference base, and the alternate base for our variant. The rest of the fields can be filled in as dot, denoting that we do not have this information for that particular variant. And similarly, a VCF file can be created like this for variants that we have curated from literature. Variant annotation tools can also accept other types of variant notations, such as the SGVS notations for a variant, or in fact, a text file containing a list of several SGVS notations that you may have curated. You may also use a text file containing a list of RSIDs for variants if you know them, and this can also be used as an input to the annotation tools. Let us now look at one such annotation tool, which is Variant Effect Predictor or VEP. Variant Effect Predictor is provided by Ensemble and is a powerful tool for annotating genomic variants. It is available in different forms as a web interface and also as a downloadable command line tool. For this tutorial, we shall explore the web version of Variant Effect Predictor that is available at this link. This is what the Variant Effect Predictor website looks like, and there are four important things that you need to observe on this page. First is the species name. Variant Effect Predictor is not only limited to humans for annotating variants, it supports a lot many other species also. So before beginning your annotation task, you must check if the species name has been selected correctly. Next is the build or the assembly version for which the tool has been built. By default, the GRCS38 version of the tool will open. And in case you're looking for the GRCS37 or the SG19 version, you can click on the link that they have provided below. Variant Effect Predictor accepts a variety of input file formats, including the three that we have discussed before, which is the VCF format, variant identifiers in the form of RSIDs or SGVS notations. This tool also provides an option to select a database for annotating genes and gene names. Since you are already familiar with the RefSeq database, we shall go ahead and use this for annotating our variants. And of course, there are additional configurations that you can set before using web. So as an example, let's go ahead and annotate the variant that you had curated in the previous session from literature, which was the variant for Lynch syndrome. And this is the corresponding NMID and NCID that we had curated for the variant. So let's see what Variant Effect Predictor annotates this variant as. This is the website for Variant Effect Predictor. And as you can see, by default, the Homo sapiens has been selected as the species name, along with the build version, which is GRCS38. Optionally, you can provide a name for your job of annotating variants. So I'll give it the name GVACI case 1. For input, you can either paste your variants or you can upload a file containing your variants. Since we are annotating only one variant right now, I'll go ahead and paste that variant here. You can choose which transcript database to use for annotating your variant. And we will go ahead with the RefSeq database. And you can provide additional configurations for annotating your variants, such as what identifiers you want to use, gene symbols, transcript versions, and so on. You can choose to annotate your variant against known variants that are reported in databases like DBSNP, or annotate the frequency data for these known variants if they are reported in databases like 1000 Genomes, ESP, NOMAD, etc. So if you want to display these annotations, you can go ahead and select them also. Then you can choose additional annotations such as the transcript biotype, such as if the variant is a protein coding variant or not, and so on. You can annotate the exon and intron number for the variant. And you can attach phenotype data, such as what disease is known against the variant and other such phenotype data. And this information can also be annotated against your variant. Moving on to computational prediction tools, Variant Effect Predictor provides SIFT and Polyfin annotations for your variant, along with other such prediction tools, such as DBNSFP and CAD. And also tools based on conservation. You can optionally also provide configuration to filter your results, such as that by variant frequency. Since we are entering only one variant right now, let us not apply any pre-filters and go ahead and run this job by clicking on Run. When I click on Run, the job will get submitted to the Variant Effect Predictor server that is being maintained by Ensemble. And this job panel will show you the status of your job. Right now it is queued, which means our job has been submitted and will be processed soon. Depending on the number of variants that you submit as a job, and depending on how busy your how busy the variant effect predictor server is, it should take about a few minutes to finish the task of annotating your variants. Once variant effect predictor has finished running and annotating your variant, it will show the job status as finished or done. And you can view the results by clicking on the link given here. At the top, it will provide some summary statistics about the variant input that it has processed, such as the number of variants processed, how many novel and how many existing variants were found in the input list, and so on. And scrolling down, we can see the results. For each variant entered, variant effect predictor will annotate a number of features against the variant. And you can see and hide these features by clicking here and choosing what all information and features to display and what to hide. So we'll go ahead and display SIFT and POLYFIN scores and allele frequency information that has been mapped through different genome sequencing and exome sequencing projects like NOMAD and 1000 Genomes. You can also choose to view the clinical significance on the variant that has been reported in known databases and the phenotype and or disease reported against it. Variant effect predictor will also map the molecular consequence of the variant. For each variant in that you had input, variant effect predictor will annotate different molecular consequences for the variant based on the different transcript IDs that have been generated due to alternate splicing. So the molecular consequence of the variant that we had input, which has the SGVS ID as this one, is stop gained, which means it is a variant in which a codon is changed, resulting in a premature stop codon, leading to a shortened transcript. And the gene in which the variant lies is MSH2. If you click on the gene ID here, you can view more information about the gene in which the variant lies. The biotype is protein coding, and the variant lies in exon 2 out of the 16 exons of MSH2 gene. And similarly, other features such as amino acid changes, position of the amino acid change, the RSID for the already reported variant, and the SIFT POLYFIN scores will be displayed as you scroll to the right. This will also display the clinical significance of the variant that has been reported in databases like ClinVar. So as we can see, this variant has been reported to be pathogenic in ClinVar. And we can click on this plus icon here to see what phenotypes have been associated with this pathogenic variant. So, a number of phenotypes have been reported, including hereditary cancer predisposing syndrome and Lynch syndrome as well. So, in this way, we can use variant effect predictor to annotate a variant of our interest. As a second example, let us take a case of a patient presenting with breast tumors. The patient has a family history of breast cancer, and it is suspected that the patient has mutations in the BRCA1 gene, a gene that has been known to be associated with breast cancer. For this exercise, we will be inputting a variant calling format file or a VCF file into the variant effect predictor. This sample VCF file that I have created contains six variants that are shown here, one in chromosome 1 at this position, and so on. So let us go back to the variant effect predictor website. To submit a new job, you can scroll down and click on the new job option here, and you will be redirected to the webpage that we saw initially. So I can give it a name, case 2. And I can upload my VCF file that I have on my system, which is called practicecase2.vcf. Again, I want to use RefSeq transcripts to annotate the variants. I want to know the gene symbol and the transcript version. I also want to know what is the frequency reported for these variants in the different population genome databases, and if known variants and their RSIDs are there. Additionally, I would like to annotate the exon and intron numbers and phenotypes and diseases that have been known to be associated with these variants. For computational predictions, I would like to view SIFT and Polyfin that have already been selected. And I would like to apply no prior filtering options or advanced options. So I will go ahead and submit this job to Variant Effect Predictor. Again, depending on the number of variants and how free the server is, my job should take around a few minutes to run and complete. So now my second job has finished running, which is case 2. I can go ahead and view the results. And this is the result table generated for the variants that I had input. Again, to alternate splicing, Variant Effect Predictor has annotated the different transcripts for all the variants. Now I'll go ahead and display important information such as allele frequency reported in population databases. And I'd also like to know what are the phenotypes or diseases associated with the variants that I had input. So I'll go ahead and click this also. And as you can see, Variant Effect Predictor has attached a lot of features against the variants that I had entered. Now, since we have suspect that the mutation is probably in the BRCA1 gene, we can use the filter option provided here by Variant Effect Predictor to go ahead and filter the gene according to its name. So the symbol column here is what contains the gene names. So I can apply the filter symbol is and enter BRCA1. And Variant Effect Predictor will filter the results based on the filter that I had input, which is view only those variants that lie in the BRCA1 gene. Now I want to know what is the allele frequency that has been reported for the variants in the BRCA1 gene that are there in my patient. So as you can see, the allele frequency is well below 0.005, which means that it is all these variants are rare variants and not commonly reported in healthy individuals. So this is some increasing evidence that this variant or this disease may be pathogenic or disease causing for my patient. Also, if I look at computational prediction scores of SIFT and Polyfin, for these variants, SIFT has predicted all these variants in the BRCA1 gene to be deleterious, while Polyfin has also predicted them to be possibly damaging or probably damaging, except for this variant here that has been predicted as benign. Now, if we look at the clinical significance that has been reported against the variants that I had input in ClinVar, it says conflicting interpretations of pathogenicity. So some submitters say that the variant is likely benign, some say it's benign, and some say it is of uncertain significance. And clicking on the phenotype column, we can see breast and ovarian cancer, breast and ovarian cancer familial, and so on. So which brings us to another challenge, that what does conflicting interpretations of pathogenicity even mean? So even though we can now annotate variants and understand different features about the variants, there are still certain challenges that remain in understanding the variant and its clinical significance. There might be differences in how I understand the annotations and how some other person may understand that annotation. There might be differences in reporting the evidence. What may seem like strong evidence to me that the variant is pathogenic may not be a very strong criteria indeed. And there might be difference in reporting the clinical significance of the variant, as we have seen in this example, that some people are reporting the variant to be likely benign, and some people are reporting the variant to be of uncertain significance. So to solve this problem, a set of standard guidelines is needed that can help standardize the task of reporting and interpreting these genetic variants, which is exactly what is done and provided by the ACMG and AMP guidelines, which is the American College of Medical Genetics and Genomics and the Association for Molecular Pathology. ACMG and AMP provide a robust criteria for interpreting sequence variants, and you will learn more about the ACMG-AMP guidelines for interpreting the variants in the further sessions. So this was all for today's session on annotating variants using web resources. I hope you have understood the concepts explained in this session. Thank you for paying attention.